Hello, welcome to your guide to the world of wine. I'm Michelangelo. Today we're going to be talking about sparkling wine. Now, if it's coming from the Champagne region of France, it's called Champagne. The Germans call it Sekt, the Spanish call it Cava, but the rest of the world we call it sparkling wine. Now, there are three methods to creating sparkling wine. There is the carbonation or injection method, where a tank of still wine under pressure has CO2 gas injected into it, very similar to what's going on with a soda pop or a sparkling water. There is the tank or charmat method, where the secondary fermentation, instead of being done in the bottle, is done in the tank. Now, with the tank method, you tend to get more of a fruit-forward style of sparkling wine, not that traditional yeasty, bready characteristic that we'll get from a sparkling wine that's gone through the method traditionnel or the method champenois. For the traditional champenois method, you're going to start with your base wine. In Champagne, there are three varietals that are permitted. Chardonnay, which is a white grape. You've got the Pinot Noir, which is a red grape. And Pinot Meunier, which is also a red grape. But here in the U.S., we tend to stick with Pinot Noir and Chardonnay, those Burgundian varietals, really what we do well here in the Canaros region. We're going to start off by creating a base wine, a blending of the grape varietals that you're using. Of course, here you can use whatever you want, but typically we stick to those two varietals. Once you're happy with your base wine, that will go into the bottle. Now, to create that secondary fermentation that's going to get those bubbles going, we need to add the liqueur de tirage. Now, that's going to consist of a yeast, sugar, and a clarifying agent. Now, the yeast is going to create another fermentation. Of course, the sugar is what the yeast is going to eat. And the byproduct of that fermentation, there's going to be CO2, and that's what's going to create the bubbles in the sparkling wine. The clarifying agent is added to allow the yeast to work its way through the wine when we're ready to expend it. So now we have our ability to create that secondary fermentation in the bottle. But we need to go ahead and seal this off so it is a sealed vessel so that CO2 gas cannot escape. So we'll put a crown cap on there, but before the crown cap goes on there, we're going to have a little plastic cup, and that cup's going to catch these spent yeast cells. The crown cap is used because it is removable. So when the fermentation goes on, the yeast eat up the sugar, creating that CO2 gas, but now we have dead yeast inside of the bottle. So the sparkling wine will go into a pegboard, starting horizontal, working its way vertical, and that's going to take a process over several months. The bottle is going to be twisted slightly. It's also going to be raised up so that yeast is going to work its way down into that cap. That's the riddling process. So once that's been completed, we have that plug of yeast that's now at the very top of the bottle. And at that point, the bottle would be completely upside down. At which point, we're going to take that bottle, submerge it into a tank of solution that's just below freezing. It's going to freeze that cap there, allowing us to remove that spent yeast. So the crown cap will be removed, that plug of yeast will be shot out, and this all happens very rapidly. The dosage is added at that point. What the dosage is a little bit more wine to fill up that gap, but it's also a sweetening agent, so there's natural sugars that are added to that. Now, we think of sparkling wine as being very dry, and it is, but it's also very, very acidic. So there's always some sugar that's added to a sparkling wine to kind of balance it out a little bit. And now it's time for my favorite part, the tasting of the wine. Now, since we do have this bottle under pressure, it's going to be a little bit different than opening a regular bottle of wine. We have to be very careful because there is about 6 atmospheres worth of pressure built up in this bottle. Most of the sparkling wines are going to be capped off the same here. We've got our little foil, so there's usually a little pull tab. So you can remove that pull tab all the way around. And I'm going to do this as if it was a fine dining experience, that proper table service. So we'll remove the top of the foil, and we'll start to remove the cage. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 twists for the cage. Now we need to make sure we keep our hand on top of the bottle because at any point it could release. So I'm going to go ahead and cover that up with a towel here to make sure that if it does release on us, we're not going to make a mess. So the cap has been loosened. Now it's time to remove the bottle. And we really don't want to make any noise. Slight twist of the bottle, removing the bottle from the cork. And that's about all we should hear. And when pouring sparkling wine, of course, since there are bubbles, we need to be careful. Now you see some people tilting the glass when they pour. Not necessary if it's done right. And we We see those bubbles start to climb. We want to do a slow, even, steady pour. That way we can fill it up in one shot. That looks just about right. We'll move on to the second glass. Now, if we pour too fast, of course, we're going to make a really big mess. So even, steady pour is the best. One shot as it is. And now we get to try some of this beautiful reserve Pinot Noir Brut from Chandon. Why don't you give it a try too? Cheers.